Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. Beautiful sunshine day the Lord has made for us. That's what we're going to say, this is the day. We're going to start with this is the day that the Lord has made. Hopefully everyone has gotten up and said your prayers to the Lord this morning. Thank Him for another day, another day's journey. He watched over us last night. He woke us up this morning. That we can be here this morning to praise Him for another day. So that's why we're here, to praise Him. Yes, this is our pastor's anniversary, but we're still here. Number one mission, thing to do is to praise God. Praise God. That's the main thing. That's the main thing. So let's not lose the sight. Let's not lose the vision. Yes, we want to thank our pastor for his year of being here, but we also want to continue to praise God. Continue to praise God. So we're going to start with that. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. To thee, and my iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgivest the iniquity of my sins, Selah. For this shall everyone that is godly pray to thee in a time when thou mayest be found. Surely in the flood of great waters they shall not come nigh unto him. Thou art my hiding place. Thou shalt prepare me. Preserve me from trouble. Thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. Selah. I will instruct thee and teach thee in the ways which thou shalt go. I will guide thee with my eyes. But ye not as thy horse or as thy mule, which have no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with bit and bridle, as they come near upon thee. Many sorrows shall be to the wicked, but that he that trusteth in the Lord, mercy shall compass him about. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, ye righteousness, and shout for joy, all ye that are upright in heart. I have read you Psalms 32 in its entirety. May the Lord have blessed to reading, hearing, and doing God's will.
Amen.
Like I said, we've got bright sunshine outside. Beautiful. You look and see the flowers. You know me. I'm just into that. But I looked out my window this morning. Man cannot paint a better picture than what God puts out there. I mean, it was framed in by the picture window. And you see the flowers and the birds and oh, beautiful, beautiful. Beautiful. Man couldn't paint a better picture. So we want to praise God this day, every day, but we want to thank Him. I have to give a prayer of thanksgiving. We have altar call and come up and tell God all about your troubles. But right now, our fine men to have a enter the Rawson there. We just wanted to praise God today. Thank God for His men of the word. Thank God for you that are here today. For only God knows what you're going through right now. You know, but we can't praise Him. It says to praise Him regardless of your situation, regardless of what you're going through. Always praise God. Always. So as we prepare for this prayer, just think of His goodness and where He's brought you from up until this point. May we pray for this. Our Father, who art in heaven, greatness be thy name. We come right now, Lord, praising you for this day. Thanking you for last night's lying down, this early morning rise and sending us on our way. We come acknowledging you as Lord and Master, the great creator, the one that created the stars and the moon, placed them in their place, made the day, made the night, made the evenings. Lord, you made everything. Everything belongs to you. Our houses, our vehicles, our clothing, our food. It's all because of you, Lord. Because of your mercy and your grace, watching over us, looking past our faults, supplying us with our needs. We thank you this day, O Lord. We thank you for letting us come up this morning, rise up this morning, look out the window upon your perfect picture that you've made for us. Lord, we thank you for the many choices that you've given us, what to eat, what to wear. But Lord, forgive us of our sins this day. Cleanse us of all unrighteousness, filled with your love that we might be about your business, and that's steering the lost to you. But we thank you for Jesus,
thank you.
And hung and bled and died on Calvary's cross for the sin of the world, Lord. It had to be him, because it couldn't be anyone else. It had to be the perfect lamb, and he was. We thank you for your sacrifice of your son, but we know we're unworthy of that. So for, we just want to thank you for your grace, we thank you for your mercy. We thank you for Jesus to hung there and died on Calvary's cross. And Lord, we ask your blessings upon Mount Olive today. Please be with us in this gathering. We know you're hearing right now, Father, but we ask that you manifest yourself in a special way. That something might be said that touches someone in a special way, that it might come running, asking, what must I do to be saved? Blessings upon the man who's going to preach the word today, O Lord. Thank you for his traveling grace, and we pray the same for his safe return, O Lord. Blessings upon our pastor, Father. We know that every day is your day, but this is his anniversary, so we just want to praise, thank you for our pastor. Thank you for the year that he's been here and guiding us in the direction that you have us to go. Blessings upon those who are unable to be here today for whatever reason. Touch the bereaved families, Lord. We know that you can lift up a bowed down head. You can ease a troubled heart. So we just want to thank you for being there for us to call upon in times of trouble. Lord, be with us the remainder of the service. And we hope that it's pleasing to you, O Father, and that you might get all the praise and all the glory within him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So we just want to praise God today. And in the song, we just want to praise him from the rising of the sun to the going down of the sun. So please join in and help us. Because like I said, we're up here to lead the praise, but only you can praise God for yourself. You know what he's doing for you in your life. So join in, everyone, please. Praise him. Praise him.
Melodies from heaven.
Friday, April 29th, we have our appreciation dinner for our First Lady, Donna White.
Amen.
And it will be at MCL at 6 o'clock.
Amen.
Carolina are asking you to come a little early so they can get you organized to go through the line.
Amen.
And also, if you haven't signed up, you need to sign up today. The sign up sheet is out in the Christmas. On Saturday, April the 30th, the Sheroes will meet here at Mount Olive at 1 o'clock. So if you know any young ladies, this is a good program. It's by one of our young ladies that was brought up through the church.
Amen.
She's a leader there. She has a program in Indianapolis, so she's trying to extend it here.
That's right.
Please get the young ladies here on Saturday at 1 o'clock. Also on April the 30th, Mount Moriah is having a pre-Mother's Day event, and it's going to be held at the Community Family Center. And it's a luncheon. It's going to be from 2 to 5, and the tickets are $7. And also, one of our speakers is going to be Miss B.
That's right. Amen.
So if you plan on attending, the tickets are $7. And also, Sister Bentley also informed me that they are holding tickets for Mount Olive, so you can get them at the door if you want them to go.
Thank you.
Also on Sunday, June 5th, we will be going to Hosek's Baptist Church for Pastor Moorhead's pastoral anniversary. So I do still have that list, so you know, please sign up, get with me if you're interested in going. And we do have visitors, so I'm not going to ask you to stand up. So I'd just like to welcome you. And thank you for coming out to worship with us and praise and fellowship for our first pastoral anniversary for Pastor White.
Amen.
See, the choir has two celebrity guests today. See them there. A couple things, as y'all know, Dr. Boyd has been here this afternoon. Next week, Butler from Reno, Nevada will be here. And then we're going to close out with the second half of Mount Moriah afternoon. So we ask that you take part in those worship celebrations as well. I want to inform you, some of you may not know, Sister Norma Griffin would only be with the Lord on Tuesday. So her funeral will be this coming Thursday. The calling will be from 10 to 12. And the funeral will be again at 12. And so just please plan accordingly. Talked and met with the family already. And so inspire for those that are available.
Right.
Being asked to sing at least one selection. Maybe we have a solo or something, but at least one selection. Then we just have to do what we do for those who are with
them.
You know, she was a faithful member.
Yes.
She didn't just hit and miss.
Right.
Matter of fact, she would be here. I'm here most Sundays between 7 and 7:30. She'd be the first one here. Larry brings her. And she's the first one waiting in her classroom every Sunday.
After she brings the salmon patties.
Yeah, after she brings the salmon patties. And you know, she was an amputee. But she also was baptized.
Amen.
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 So we have able-bodied people that won't even come around the corner.
Amen.
She's an amputee, had a prosthetic put on, and went with us to Kokomo. Climbed up the step of the bus. And I told her family yesterday, you can, so many one-word things you can say about her, but one of them was determination.
Amen.
We want to make sure that we're here to support in a very good way her homeboy and celebration. And then one last thing, I made a discovery this week, and I'll be talking a little bit more to you about it. For years, we have said that Mount Olive was, and I hate to use this word from a man-made perspective, because Christ is the only founder of the church. But it was, quote unquote, founded in 1927. And that's not true. Mount Olive was organized in 1917. The 1927 day comes in because when the church actually first had a building erected, so they tied the birth of Mount Olive to the building versus the organization. What I'm saying is, next year, Mount Olive will be 100 years old. This year's 99, so next year's 100.
Right.
So we need to start getting some people together for the 100-year anniversary.
Amen.
Amen.
I thought I was the 8th pastor, I'm the 12th pastor. That's still a good number.
Right.
12's good. But just so you'll know, we're not changing anything. It's in writing. I have a program from 99. It's in writing that says when the church was organized. So I'm not here changing anything. We just correcting our history. And that's okay what we've done before, but it's not tied to a building. Because this can blow down, we'll still be not on. And so we'll be talking to you more about that, what we want to do, some ideas and so forth. But just kind of keep that under your hat for the time being as we move through this first anniversary for yours truly. Appreciate all that you've done. I'm excited to have my good friend here with us today. A little later on, but I'm excited. He's in demand. He was gracious enough to stop by Richmond on his way somewhere else.
All right.
Thank you.
All right.
Yeah.
Thanksgiving. Thomas said that's all right. Pray for Thomas.
Amen.
He's under the weather right now and he's facing some things going on right now.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. Eternal Father, we just want to thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity to give back what you've given to us. Bless those that have the deal. Bless those that have desire and not the need. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. May we pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for just allowing us to come out before your presence today, Father. It's such a beautiful day, Father, and we just know that you're just smiling right now. And Father, you just go and reach in and just touch our hearts, Father. And just allow us to just express the joy that comes from knowing and serving a true living God. Father, we ask that you take this offering and you use it for the uplifting and glorification of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
There's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in his name.
Amen.
Amen. Church say amen.
Amen.
It's prayer time. Won't you come to the altar? We all stand in need.
My.
Of prayer.
Yes.
Pray without ceasing.
My.
For the one in front of you, for the one behind you, for the one beside you. Whatever your problem is, he said, cast all your cares upon him.
Yeah.
He's able to lift up a bow down in this morning. Care what you're struggling on, care what you're going through. If you just give it to the Lord, he's able this morning. Pray for the Griffin family. Continue to pray for the Head family. All those that bereaved me. Pray for the family that lost a 2-year-old. Pray for that family. If the Lord's will, the next anniversary coming up.
Yeah.
Michael Burke, continue to pray for him. We're going to ask Pastor Steve Jones if he will lead us to the throne of grace this morning.
Amen.
Liberty First Baptist.
Let us pray if you will. Gracious Lord, our Heavenly Father, Maker and our Creator, the Sustainer and the Supplier of our every need. It's again, Lord Master, we come looking to the hills, which cometh all of our help. For we realize that all of our help comes from you. And without you, we can do nothing. We come this morning, O God, just to give you all the honor, the glory, and the praises, realizing that you are worthy to be praised. Because if it were not for you, we would not be here this morning. But because of your amazing grace, you have allowed our golden moments to roll on a little while longer. Lord Master, we doesn't know what lies on this afternoon. But we just want to say thank you for right now. We thank you for being so good to us. You have been better to us than we have even been to ourselves.
Thank you.
But you just brought us from a mighty, mighty long way. We just want to give you the honor and the glory for allowing us to be here today. We thank you for your watch care last night. We realize that it was you that watched over all night long while we slumbering, while we sleeping. Right early this morning, you dispatched one of your angels from glory and touched us with the fingertips of love and waking us up out of our sleeping and starting us on another day's journey. We just want to say thank you right now. When we rose this morning, we had the right frame of mind. Blood yet running warm in our veins. We just want to thank you, oh God, for our reasonable portion of health and strength. We were able to get out of our bed this morning, and we had our eyesight. We were able to look around in our home and find that we're well with our companions and with our family. We just want to say thank you. We just want to say thank you, oh God, for you put food on our tables and you gave us water to drink. Lord, we just want to say thank you for having a roof over our head. Lord, we thank you for your amazing grace. We thank you, Lord, for your love and your compassion, your long-suffering, your kindness, and your goodness. Lord, we just want to say thank you. We thank you for your darling son, Jesus, who shed his blood out on Calvary on Friday and died in our stead. But early that Sunday morning, he got up out of the grave with all power of heaven and earth in his hand. Lord, we just want to say thank you. We thank you, oh God, for your traveling grace this morning. You allowed us to come from here and there to be here at your house this morning. We thank you, oh God, for being so good to us. Then we ask, oh God, that you would bless whosoever standing in need of prayer. Those who ask for prayer this morning, oh God, we ask that you would just touch them, oh God. Realize that you are able to supply all of their needs. And we heard about the Griffin family, oh God, Sister Norman. We ask, oh God, that you would bless that family. Help them, oh God, to look to the hills, which come with all of our help, because all of our help comes from you. And without you, we can do nothing. We stand this morning leaning, independent on you, oh God. We ask in the mighty name of Jesus that you would bless the pastor of this church, oh God. So this first year anniversary, oh God, strengthen and lift him up, oh God. Help him to lead your people in the way that you would have them go. Help him to continue to preach an uncompromising gospel. And the one that's going to preach your word this morning, God, let him down into your storehouse of knowledge. Crown his head with more wisdom and knowledge. Come on now. Give him the revelation of your word. And after giving him the revelation of your word, help him, oh God, to preach your word. Bless each and every home that are represented here this morning. Bless this son of man, woman, girl, or boy that doesn't know them in the part of their sin. Let your word penetrate their stony heart, that they might come running this morning, asking, what must they do? Bless the remaining of this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's say amen. Amen.
Before the choir comes, I want to take this time to go ahead and introduce the speaker for the hour, introduce the song, present to others, Dr. Bruce Rhodes, pastor teacher at the Second Baptist Church in Bloomington, Indiana. He's been there for 12 years. We were down a couple years ago and celebrated his 10th anniversary, I believe. All the church went down there. He is a friend of mine. We're going through some things. And he called me and left me a message. And he left a prayer on the message. And I kept it for a good 6 or 7 years until I changed. When you change the horizon, you know, you lose everything. So he had to call me and give me another prayer. Got a new phone and everything, you know. But I used to just play that prayer back. Then more recent things that I've had to deal with, he's always called and checked on me, and it always ended up, let's have a word of prayer. There was no gossip. It was just simply seeking the face of God. And that is something that is, you take it to eternity with you. Someone that's objective, spiritually objective like that, and shares with you from his heart the word of God. And been friends a good, I don't know how many years now, been a good little while. And I appreciate his friendship and fellowship. We already know, we've heard him before, I think Pastor Randall's banquet at Earl. Mercy. Yeah, I think it was on television for a good while. Brother Wynn did just get to put that back on. And you just have to hear it for yourself. I can't even explain it. You just have to hear it for yourself. And then you be the determinant. After the choir will sing, the next voice you'll hear will be that of Dr. Bruce Rose, pastor of the Second Baptist Church of Bloomington, Indiana.
My love. people say amen.
Amen.
To the angel of the house, my friend, pastor, Sister Donna's husband.
Amen. Amen.
I just want to say thank you, my friend,
for
sharing this preaching place. To Sister Donna and Pastor Wyatt, congratulations on your first year anniversary.
Amen.
We love you.
Amen.
And I ain't afraid to tell
nobody.
Pastor Jones, all of my fellow commentators of Christ, and Mount Olive. It's good to be here.
Amen.
I have to apologize right away because when Pastor Wyatt called me and asked me if I could come, I heartily agreed, readily agreed, and that's when I made my mistake. I had to check the calendar. I'm just saying, if Derek say come, I'm coming.
Yeah.
And was grateful for the opportunity, but I had double booked today. Didn't check with the secretary, but it all worked out. The Lord has a plan.
Amen.
So I was able to come this morning. This afternoon, I'm going to my hometown of Terre Haute, and one of my friends is celebrating his 20th pastoral anniversary. So I apologize, the second's not with me this morning, and we will get a rain check.
Amen.
We'll be with you soon. So right after this worship service, I have to excuse myself and get on the road and go to the other side of the state. Amen. So they'll pray for me and with me. But I'm just so glad to be here this morning.
Amen.
I had a sister that passed away on last week, and as we were going through our period of bereavement and doing our homegoing celebration preparation the night before viewing, I looked up and who was there? Your pastor and his wife. Your hours of sorrow and bereavement, it's good to see somebody that you respect and love, that they take time out of their busy schedules and come see about you. So Pastor White and Sister White, I just want to say thank you. I really love you, and I thank you for your support. Pastor Jones here, he followed me into First Baptist Church in Liberty, Indiana, but he's done a lot better than I. He's been there 20-some years. Glad to see Sister Sawyer there, and all of you here at Mount Olive. Is there any word from the Lord? Amen.
Amen.
Yes, there is a word from the Lord. I asked Pastor White if I could take my time this morning. And he says, do what you need to do. I'm just going to take my time and share the word of God. Is that all right? Mount Olive, I am so proud of you. I'm praying for you all the time. You know, Pastor White talked about how I was a support to him, but he just didn't know in so many ways how he has supported me throughout my ministry. He so often is such a great Bible scholar that I've learned so much from Pastor White.
Amen.
I'm telling you, I mean books and encouragement and prayers and you name it, he has been there for me, and I just love your pastor so very much. Let us pray. Eternal Father, consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of thy grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and let my will be totally lost in thine. Father, we're reminded that we are not here by accident. We're only here today because of your divine providence. We're not here because we are lucky, because Christians do not have luck. We're here today because we've been blessed by the absolute best. Father God, we're reminded, Lord God, that every time we open up your Bible, that you speak to us. So Father, it's our prayer once again that you would speak to our hearts, our minds, our souls, our circumstances, and our own individual situations, and give us what we need at this juncture of our life. Father God, we ask your blessings upon the pastor and his wife and their family, Lord. Continue to hold them up, Lord, and we'll be careful to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. Father, we would be remiss, Lord, if we did not pray for that man, woman, boy, or girl that has not accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit would take your word, convict their hearts, their mind, and their life, And when the invitation to Christian discipleship is extended, we pray, Father God, that you would let them just to take the walk of faith. Give us their hand, but give you their heart. And Lord, we'll be careful to give you all the honor and all the praise that we can. It's in Jesus' name we ask it all. Amen. And all the people said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. My hands are sweating and my heart is racing. That's all right. That's all right. God is able to supply our every need according to his riches in glory. Now, when I met your pastor a long time ago, I met him and he introduced us to Nick. That was one of the greatest things and one of the greatest answers to my prayer that I had in the ministry. I was looking for how can we do evangelism and discipleship. But if you pray, the Lord will answer. Amen. Is there any witnesses in the house that the Lord still answers prayer? Amen. Amen. So I know, and I read the letter. I've got the letter right here in front of me. I know what the theme is, the 2 Thessalonians 2, 13 and 14. And there's so much meat in that scripture, but that's not how the Lord's leading me today. But I just want to say something about your theme because it is action-packed. It is fulfilling. The pastor and people thanking God for his faithfulness. Yeah, but you know what? You can't thank God. I always say, where there is no thinking, there is no thanking. And if you have not taken the time to think about the God who made the heavens and the earth, there can never be any thinking in the house. But I'm grateful that God is able to supply our every need. So here's what I want to do. Some of you in that, you know the song. I want to be a follower. Chapter 9, the 23rd verse.
All right.
In the gospel
according to Luke, chapter 9, the 23rd verse. Dr. Luke had some words that he was instructed to pen as he was moved by the Holy Spirit. Dr. Luke was a detailed writer. Yeah. Dr. Luke has some words from the Lord. If you're in Luke chapter 9 at verse 23, say amen.
Amen.
If you need me to wait, please say wait. Yeah, sounds like everyone is at Luke chapter 9, verse 23. In Luke chapter 9, the 23rd verse, these are the words that are recorded. And I pray that in your quiet time and meditation time, that you would just read all of this chapter.
All right.
Here in the 23rd verse, it says, and he said to them what?
All.
To them all. And he said to them all.
All.
If any man will what? Let him deny himself and what? I just want to take my time talking a little bit. Is that all right?
Yeah.
I want to examine. I want to investigate. I want to analyze. I want to dissect, if you will, just one single verse of scripture. Yeah. I like to try to paint. I'm not a very good artist, but I like to try to paint within the framework of this 23rd verse of the 9th chapter of the book of Luke. Now, before I can deal with this verse, I can already hear some of the short waves rumbling, throughout Mount Olive, that this is indeed a familiar passage of scripture and some familiar landscape for you. Yeah. I know Pastor White is one of the best Bible instructors that God has on this side of the Jordan. I'm sure he may have already taught this, but don't draw any definite conclusions yet. Let's wait and see the picture that the Holy Spirit, will paint for you today. Yeah. In the 23rd verse, he says clearly, and he said to them all, Jesus, was talking to his disciples, not one in particular, but to every one of them. And Jesus said to them all, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. Yeah, I want to talk about this morning four simple things that can be found in this scripture. I want to talk about divine direction. And then I want to talk about daily discipline. I want to talk about, the denial of desire. And then I want to talk about these other three cannot happen unless there is an act of the will. First of all, there must be divine direction. Thank you, choir. And then there must be daily discipline. And then there has to be a denial of desire. And they all have to center around the act of the will. Now, Pastor White, I honestly believe, with a settled conviction in my heart, this conviction is non-negotiable. There's no room for discussion with me. And I believe that nothing of any significance happens to a person until he or she deals with the will. Now, let me tell you that intellectual knowledge, and I got a whole bunch of folk in my congregation that's got PhDs, and they teach at Indiana University, and they're all of that, and a bag of chips, but I'm convinced that intellectual knowledge alone is not enough. I'm convinced that emotional stimulation of the moment is not enough. Anything that is significant has to come out of
the will. Yeah. We have to learn how to obey. Yeah. Yeah. We have to function as ordered by the divine order, even when we don't feel like it. Yeah. Now let me see if I can help to paint the first portion of the picture. It's all by an act of will. Yeah. I got some questions for you, Mount Olive. First of all, April the 18th, they gave us a few extra days this year. Taxes were due, amen? Yeah. My question for you is, how did you pay your income taxes? Well, the answer is by an act of will. Yeah. I got a question for you. How did you get up this morning when you felt like staying in the bed? Yeah. You did it by an act of will. How do you pay your car note? The answer is because I'm sure if you're like me and you don't say, wow, I get a chance to pay my car note today. No, you did it by an act of will. And to be sure, after the act of will, there's a good feeling that always comes after you've done what you need to do. Let me see if I can help you. Every mother, and some fathers, you can identify with the act of will, because I'm sure you can recall around 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, when mama, daddy hopped up out of the bed to change a diaper, to feed, the baby with some milk, to take care of some of the need of the baby. Mothers and some daddies don't feel like getting up out of the bed, but in seeking the best for their baby, the object of their love, they get up out of the bed and do what needs to be done, and it's simply by the act of will. And when we get back in the bed, you do remember, don't you? You feel a sense of satisfaction that the object of your love has now been dried, clean, fed, and satisfied. It gives you some pleasure on the inside after the act of will. So Jesus, when you look at the scripture, never relied on feelings, for people to follow him. You can't follow Jesus with your feelings, because church folk will hurt your feelings. Yeah, they will. You cannot follow Jesus with feelings, because feelings fluctuate. Sometimes up, and sometimes down, almost leveled to the ground. Jesus, did not base faith on our feelings. He said, you act in faith, and then your feelings will be the caboose. You'll feel the satisfaction.
Now, that dates me.
I was riding with my younger nieces and nephews just the other day, and a train stopped us in Cherokee. And I said, it's strange for me because there's no caboose. Uncle Bruce, they said, what's a caboose? But I gotta tell you, that's the way when we were growing up. We knew it was the end of the train coming. There'll come satisfaction in your soul after you follow God by faith and not by feelings. Now, having said that, let me say a word about the text. Let me say a word about this verse. In the onset, the first word I suggested was about divine direction. And I think that's really important, because it's right here in the word. And I always tell my folk, and if I can't look it up in the word, I'm going to assume you made it up. Because either you can look it up, or I think you made it up.
If somebody tells you something about the Word of God, you better make sure you can look it up, because people will make things up about the Word of God. I didn't make it up this morning. You look it up. Yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh. Have you really ever asked yourself? Yeah. Yeah, about divine direction. It's right here in this verse, because Jesus said, you need to follow me. Isn't that in your Bible? Yeah, isn't that in the 23rd verse in Luke chapter 9? Did not Jesus say, follow me? Yeah. Well, the first thing that Jesus is suggesting is that the position is settled. Yeah, he said, follow. Isn't that what it says? I wonder if y'all gonna pray with me this morning. He said, follow. Yeah. The position is settled. Yeah, now if you get a chance, I want you to do some comparing and contrasting in your quiet time and meditation time. I want you to go back to the gospel according to Mark chapter 1, verse 17. And in Mark chapter 1, verse 17, it says, Jesus is talking, come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. Yeah, the position, watch this, is already set. Yeah, the position is not alongside. The position is not in front of Jesus. The position is settled. If I am going to be a disciple, a disciplined disciple, then I have to follow Jesus, And in order to follow Jesus, I have to have close proximity to him. Have you ever followed anybody? Now, I was at Sister Sawyer's son's funeral out in California a few weeks ago, and I didn't know where I was going. And as we were moving and shaking, trying to get to the place for the worship experience and the homegoing service, I had to follow someone. Yeah. Well, now when you think about it and you follow someone, you have to stay close enough. Well, the first thing you don't want is anybody in between you and the person you are following. That reminds me, Pastor White, of a song they used to sing when I was growing up. Nothing between my soul and the Savior. None of this world's elusive dreams. I have renounced all sinful pleasures. So there's nothing between me and my Savior. Between me and the Lord. And why not? Because you know when you follow somebody, you don't want anybody in between. You don't want an Uber driver between you. You don't want a trike between you. You don't want another car between you. Because you want to stay close to the leader. And the reason you want to stay close is so that you can follow the course. Why do you want to follow the course? I'm glad you asked. Because you do not know the way. That's why he gave you an under shepherd. He's the shepherd, the chief shepherd. But he gave us under shepherds so that you can know the way. Well, now that would suggest, that there's some type of commitment on your part to keep your eyes on Jesus. That's how it's done. Now watch it. There are so many distractions and so many different voices that could and can be heard as we walk from here to there on the stage of life. Some voices to distract you some voices to detour you, as you travel from here to there. But Jesus Christ, of Nazareth said, follow me, I don't know how many of us are really willing to do that, but we already have, biblical blueprint drawn up by the divine architect, and just fall in line and follow Jesus, and everything will be all right. Now, unfortunately, all of us follow, but many times we follow the wrong person, Our verse not only says that the position is settled, but watch this, it says that the person is seen. The person to follow is seen. Well, where does it say that? Glad you asked. The position is settled that we must follow. And the person is seen because Jesus said, follow me. Isn't that what he said? Jesus said, follow me. And watch this. I know, Brother Derek, you're in seminary, maybe working on your PhD now, and there's a whole bunch of intelligent folk at the cemetery and the universities. They teach us about Paul Tillich. They teach us about Socrates. They teach us about many other folk. But I gotta tell you, this word did not say to follow Paul Tillich. It did not say to follow Socrates. Some of you like the televangelists. It did not say to follow T.D. Jakes. Some of you got a manual for how to run the church. It's called the Hiscock manual. But my word did not say to follow Hiscock or Robert himself. Because the last time I looked in the scripture, I did not see any nail scars on Robert's hands. No matter how many rules he may have written, Robert's rules of order does not give you life. And Jesus said, the position is settled. And Jesus said, the person can be seen. And the person is me. Now, when you get a chance, I want you to look at Mark 1:17 again. Because Jesus said another word. Jesus said, follow me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. This means, that the purpose is stated. The position is settled. The person is seen. And the purpose is stated. So then I take these three conclusions, that the position is settled, to follow. The person is seen in me, and the purpose is stated to me, that if I am not fishing for men, then I am not following Jesus. Then I am not following Jesus. Watch this. No matter how loud I might sing, no matter how sweet I might preach, if I'm not fishing for men, then I am not following Jesus.
Is it okay if I take my time? Now this brings me to another suggestion. You notice that none of what I've said about following Jesus will ever happen unless you take up your cross. Now watch it. This is an area that I've thought about a lot. And it certainly deals with preconceived conceptions. What is the cross about that this verse speaks about? Now watch it. A whole lot of people have their crops mixed up
with the cross. A lot of things we claim as crosses are actually crops from the seeds we have sown through our experiences. Yeah, let me suggest, first of all, what is not a cross? Yeah, the fact that, a man's wife scalded him with some hot water is not that man's cross. It might be a result of a bad choice. It might be a result of some bad behavior, but that is not a cross. I thought, I can hear the man say, I thought she was a sugar plum, but found out she ended up being a sour lemon. Now, my sister died just last week at the age of 61. She had multiple myeloma, which is bone cancer. But I gotta tell you, cancer is not a cross. Yeah, I knew it would cry. Often, all the time, we hear from, the cancer, that's your cross to bear, that's your cross to bear. Cancer is not a cross. Let me say this way. Now, cancer may be a calamity, but it is not necessarily a cross. And I could go on and on with example after example of circumstances and conditions we identify as crosses, which are not. Yeah. Okay, so you say, that's not a cross. What is a cross? Watch this. Whatever else a cross is, it has three components. A true cross has three components. It is not a cross, first of all, and listen, has these three components and whatever else the Holy Spirit amplifies. First of all, above and beyond anything else, a cross is the vehicle of redemption. A cross is the vehicle of redemption. If what I claim as my cross is totally unrelated to redemption, then it is not a cross. You do know the cross, don't you? On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. But a lot of people in Bloomington, because I know it doesn't happen in Richmond, but a lot of people in Bloomington are ripping themselves off because they have never dealt with the cross. They spend their time dealing with confession, but they are not dealing with the cross. Now watch this. Confession is designed for sin, and the cross is designed for self. Confession is designed for sin, and the cross is designed for self. You see, we have been regenerated and are still being regenerated, but we have not yet been resurrected yet. And resurrection will be complete what regeneration has begun. They've got regeneration over here and over there in the future. We've got the resurrection, but there's something between regeneration and the resurrection. On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross. That's what a cross is, because when it's all said and done, the cross stands between the two. So I have to take up my cross, not just my confession of the cross I have to take up daily. It is a vehicle. When Jesus died on the cross, people were saved. When Jesus died on the cross, men were saved. When Jesus died on the cross, women were saved. When Jesus died on the cross, boys were saved. When Jesus died on the cross, little girls were saved. When Jesus died
all, the vehicle, yeah, is the vehicle, yeah, is the vehicle of redemption.
I told you I was going to take my time.
That means that if I'm not crucified, not if I'm not a crucified, committed believer, and if I come down from the cross, somebody may not be saved. Wait a minute, my cross, yeah. I heard, a Pastor Hayes Patterson once saying that he said his cross is a cross that we must take up because God wants us to be an expression, an extension, and an exhibition of the continuing ministry of redemption, which is, yeah, the incarnational truth walking around on 2 feet, releasing the perfect ministry of the Holy Spirit, who is experientially released to others through us. Now, in other words, what was he saying? I'm glad you asked. Dr. A. Lewis Patterson was really saying in all of that, that Jesus Christ wants to do through me and you. Now, what he did through his own body then, that's why we are called the body of Christ. He needed a body then, and he needs a body now. The cross is a vehicle of redemption, but not, yeah, only is the cross a vehicle of redemption. It is also that which is, watch this, voluntarily received.
All right.
A cross must be the vehicle of redemption, and it must be voluntarily received. And that means, that we've got to take it up. And that means that anything I did not voluntarily take up is not a cross. Lord, I pray that you keep my mind clear today. And the fact that I am burdened down with a wandering child, wandering aimlessly from here to there, is not a cross. Because if you have a wandering child, that is not a cross to bear. Because if you could, you would change that. Oh, yes, you would. But it is not something that you voluntarily receive. Well, I did not take up something voluntarily. That was my cross to receive. The cross is a vehicle of redemption. And secondly, if it's a cross, it must be voluntarily received. What have you described as your cross? Is it a vehicle of redemption? And did you take it up voluntarily? Let me suggest how you are to know the difference. Here's how to know whether or not it is a vehicle of redemption, and whether or not you have voluntarily received it. The Bible suggests that there will always be voices of recall. If it's a cross, it must first of all be a vehicle of redemption. Secondly, it must be voluntarily received. And if it is indeed a cross, there will always be voices of recall.
I didn't make it up. You can look it up.
Talk about it. The Bible says there will always be voices of recall.
Yes, sir.
If you are on the cross, there will always be somebody trying to call you down from the cross. Can't you? And don't you remember when Jesus was on the cross? Folks were saying, come down from the cross. Save yourself and save me. If you save others, can you save himself? Come down off the cross. And if Christ would have come down from the cross, you and I would still be lost. But I'm glad to be a follower of Christ. Now one of the reasons we seldom hear voices of recall saying, come down from the cross, is because we're already down. can anybody call me down if I'm already down? But Jesus said, take up your cross daily. I'm going to hurry now. We got up this morning, saw the sun, yeah, passing by. We saw the sun, but before the sun goes down today, somebody here will have to make a choice, and that choice will either be for personal pleasure or to take up our cross daily and follow Jesus. The tragic thing with our age today is that we base all of our gratification on pursuing perishable products for our pleasure. Such things as perishable products are just temporary. Step right on them. Yes, they are. We have to make the choice to voluntarily take up the cross of redemption and do it with discipline. This verse says how we can do it. That's why I love the Word of God. Look at the 23rd verse once again. We have talked about how the position is settled, how the person is seen, and the purpose is stated. We have said that the cross is a vehicle of redemption. It is voluntarily received in spite of the voices of recall. How can we do it? It's right there. He says in the verse, let him deny himself. And that's the denial of desire. What do I normally desire in life? There are only three things that will keep me from taking up my cross. There are only three things that will keep you from taking up your cross. One is the presentation of self. I think I heard somebody say that there is, in every one of us, a drum major instinct in the bosom of every man and woman, boy and girl. The only thing one really wants to do in life is to be at the front of the parade. And once he or she is there, everything will be all right. Now the presentation of self, which is that old sinful nature, the old sinful pride, will keep us from taking up our crosses. Oh, we would be amazed at what we could accomplish in Mount Olive and Second Baptist and all the churches of Christ if we didn't care who got the credit. But I've got four in the church. Not only to deny the desire to present yourself, we also have to deny the desire to pretend to ourselves.
What you talking about, Brad Jazz?
The reason why we don't take up our cross voluntarily is because we live on a stage of pretense. Discarding my stage face when I leave the stage. I just learned how to act like a Christian. I could be falling apart underneath the skin. And somebody asked Pastor Rose, how are you doing? And I respond by saying, I'm blessed and happy. But on the inside,
can't be falling apart. It's a stage of pretense, and you can't take up your cross if you're not honest with yourself. Everybody is not all right, and we need to lean on God every day of our lives. He said, follow me. He said, follow me. Love yourself and take up your cross daily. Miraculous ministry of the Holy Ghost. Because every miracle in the Bible, I want you to go back and check the miracles in the Bible. Every miracle in the Bible, bar none, was at the point of need. Yeah. It was performed at the point of need. So what am I saying? If there's no need in your life, there will be no miracles. And I'm a follower of Christ. I'm almost done now. Watch. Every misery is an opportunity for a miracle. Every misery. And all of us have some misery. It's just an opportunity for a miracle.
Everybody know God's still in the miracle business?
The third thing, I'm almost done.
Come on, preacher.
It's not that only can there be no presentation of self, no pretense in self. Yeah, there cannot be protection of self when you take up the cross. Don't you hear Jesus saying that no man taketh my life, but I voluntarily lay it down, meaning that I'm not going to spend all of my time trying to protect myself. He's more than the world against you. He will build a standard all around you. And let me tell you that, I gotta tell you, you better be careful how you deal with the preacher. Because God has a protective coating all around you. Oh, Brother Eric, don't worry about the medicines. Because if God is for you, he's more than the world against you. Then you just keep on praying and keep on teaching. And everything will be all right. Because the Bible says no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Oh, yes, it does. Well, now. Let me see if I can go ahead and hurry up to my clothes. When I look at how Jesus tells us to become a follower of his, to deny ourselves, take up our cross daily. Don't you know in the New Testament, somebody said that Jesus was weak, but then I tried to clarify that. Well, what you talking about? He said, I'm glad you asked, because in the New Testament, when the divine, the omnipotent one became weak, he still won. And I got to thinking about that thing. I said, yeah, you're right, because it's just like, I used to love Muhammad Ali. Go into the boxing ring. I used to watch Muhammad Ali. But it's just like going into the boxing ring with me. He comes in the ring with a cross on his head, nailed and still fighting. Christ comes into the ring with his side pierced, and he still wins. My brother and my sister, that's willpower. Yes, it is. When we think we're weak, the Bible says, then God is strong. You know, that's what Jesus did. He said, go ahead and put the nails in my hand. Go ahead and put the nails in my feet. Go ahead and put me in the grave. And then I will show you.
Jesus all around. No child of God should get upset because somebody puts you down. Even there, every experience that takes you down is an opportunity to demonstrate resurrection power. I think I heard somebody say that Jesus never said all power until he got up after man had put him down. Yeah, I like L.K. Curry. He's the pastor in Chicago. L.K. Curry said, the sign of a born-again, blood-bought child of God is that in every situation, whenever you go down, you always get up with more power than before. You got to let folks know that you will come back looking a little bit better than when you were. They may be looking for somebody dead and buried, but then when they come back and look for you, you're gone, and they hear a voice say, why look ye here for the living among the dead? He is risen, and that's power. Can't you follow the soft sandal footprints of the man from Galilee? Don't you remember when he turned water into wine? He didn't use all of his power then. Don't you remember when he fed 5,000 people with two fish and five barley loaves? He didn't use all power then. Don't you remember when out on the Mount of Transfiguration, when his hair looked like lamb's wool, his eyes like flaming balls of fire, feet shining like polished brass, voice sounding like rumbling rivers of water? All power, but just as soon as man stretched him high, stretched him wide, and dropped him low, above all, he shoved him in a borrowed tomb. He stayed there all night Friday and all day Saturday. Yeah, and I gotta tell you, I feel like preaching a while. He got up on Sunday morning. He preached to the spirits while he was down there. Yeah, they were held in prison. And then he translocated, paradise from down below and led captivity captive and stepped up on resurrection ground early Sunday morning. And for the first time in the Bible, he said Sunday morning, all power. About the act of will that I want to close out with. The act of will saturated with the ministry of the Holy Ghost. For Jesus said, if any man will, and I have to talk about any man. I have to tell you that I'm so glad that God's power is not limited to the smart folk. Paul sat at the feet of a man, studied systematic theology down in Arabia, spoke 13 languages, seven of them he spoke fluently, was a member of the Sanhedrin Council, was a Pharisee of the Pharisee, and God used him. Oh, but thank God, he was, straight from the fishing boat, and God used him too. And the reason God can use you and me is that it is not our power, it's just our personality and his power. It is not our ability, it is his ability and our availability. God will use any man, woman, boy or girl, black man, white man, rich man, poor man, Oriental, Occidental, hope of liberal, conservative, Republican or Democrat, any man, if they will follow him. And if it falls around the wheel, I don't know how you feel about it, but I couldn't sit down without telling you that I made up my mind a long time ago that I will acknowledge him as my Lord. I will build my hopes on things eternal, holding God's unchanging hand. I'm so glad
give in. God will.
Thank you.
And he's making a way right now. For somebody that do not know Christ. As that person said. The gospel has been preached this morning. If somebody here who has not accepted Christ as their personal Savior, he made a way over 2,000 years ago on Calvary's cross. When he died, they buried him, and early Sunday morning, he got up and said, "All power is in my hand." If someone is here this morning, Romans 10:9 says that thou shalt confess with thy heart, with thy mouth, believe in thy heart that Jesus died, buried, and rose again, thou shalt be saved. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Is there one this morning as we stand? Is there one this morning? He says, I stand knocking at the door. You open your heart and said, I'll come in and sort with you. Is that one? Bless you, Pastor Bruce. Gospel has been preached.
Yes.
The next minute is not promised. You want to give your life to Christ, now is the time. We have people here that are explaining to you the plan of salvation. If you're not saved, do not let this moment pass you by. Here is that one this morning. Won't you come? Then maybe somebody's looking for a church home. You just walked away and you want to come back. Now is the time. Here is that one. God bless you.
Amen.
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 Gentlemen, the main soul. Reggie, with us. Can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
I must be going deaf. I there's got to be some projection. But anyway, we want to be a blessing to him as he's been to us. We know we can't pay him because you can't pay for the gospel. You just can't pay for the gospel. But I'll tell you what, we can sure try.
You came and saved my life. All hearts clear.
Amen.
All hearts clear in the pulpit.
Amen.
All hearts clear on my left.
Amen.
All hearts clear on my right.
Amen.
Sound technician, is your heart clear?
Yes.
Ushers, are your hearts clear?
Yes.
Pastor Rose's heart is clear. Thank you, Pastor White. For sharing this preaching face with me on your first anniversary. It will always be special in my heart.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Mount Olive, for always showing hospitality and love. And now may the grace
Amen.
Of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ,
Amen.
The love of God, the communion and fellowship of the precious Holy Spirit,
Amen.
May he rest, rule, and abide with us. But Lord, before we give the amen,
amen.
We ask a special blessing upon Pastor and Sister White and their family. Father, we ask their special blessings upon Mount Olivet. Lord, we pray for Dr. Moorhead and Hosack as they travel across the highways, that you would keep them away from all hurt, harm, and danger.
Please,
help them to come and lift up the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, we ask your blessings upon the food that's been prepared, that once again we understand that you are a great provider, and we take the time to say thank you for your faithfulness. We love you and we praise you.
Amen.
In the precious name of your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ,
amen.
We ask it all. And every believer in the house said amen in the
amen.
Name of the Father.
Amen.
In the name of the Son.
Amen.
Amen.
In the name of the precious Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. God keep you. May heaven smile.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.